Last time, we looked at one of Richard Dawkins' typical defences of the improbability of evolution. This time, we'll look at his statement about one of the most amazingly brilliant scientists of the past 100 years. Let's listen again to the clip from his presentation at Idea City 07.
Fred Hoyle expressed it in his famous misunderstanding of natural selection, the great Boeing 747 example. He said to believe that life could be formed by Darwinian processes is equivalent to believing that a hurricane could blow through a junkyard and have the luck to assemble a Boeing 747. And that is an eloquent statement of the great creationist misunderstanding, which is that Darwinian evolution is a matter of chance. Of course it isn't, it's a matter of gradual cumulative natural selection, and the stress is on the word cumulative.
Hoyle was an atheist. He was a brilliant mathematician who turned his attention to astronomy, physical chemistry, and other aspects of science, including the origin of life. Many scientists had realized the impossibility of the simplest bacterium happening by chance, and tried to discover just how simple a life form could be and still meet the criteria of being alive. They were searching for the simplest possible protobacterium, which a real bacterium might have evolved from. Life is absolutely dependent on enzymes. As Richard Wolfenden pointed out, without them there would be no life at all. They speed up essential processes that would take millions of years to happen in a hundredth of a second. A number of scientists agreed on the smallest set of enzymes which were absolutely essential for life. Hoyle worked out the probability of assembling that set of enzymes. He assumed that all the amino acids, which are the building blocks of enzymes, were already there. He found the chance of just assembling these enzymes to be one chance in 10 to the power 40,000. That's not the chance of assembling the hypothetical protobacterium. That would need DNA, ribosomes, and many other things, but just to get the essential enzymes, one chance in 10 to the power 40,000. That's the chance of buying one ticket in the national lottery every week and winning 5,714 times in a row. If we consider amino acids coming together 200 times every second since the Big Bang, at every place where there's one atom of matter in the universe that the astronomers tell us about, plus in all the millions of millions of millions of hypothetical universes which we added, because Dawkins loves to talk about them, the improbability to be faced at every step would be 10 to the power 39,880, which is the same as the probability of winning the national lottery for 5,697 times in a row. Hoyle also looked at the probability of just assembling one typical protein by chance. He found it to be the same probability as filling the solar system with blind men, each with a Rubik cube, letting them twist and turn their cubes randomly and finding that they all solved the cube at the same time. This kind of improbability he called nonsense of a high order. Evolutionists, like Dawkins, claim this is a total misunderstanding of evolution because evolution doesn't happen all at once. Evolution goes step by step, one generation at a time. So these problems are not a problem at all. There are two major problems with that. Firstly, natural selection could only happen when life had already arisen. There can be no natural selection if there are no living offspring to be selected. And secondly, the probability of an event does not depend on the number of steps to get there. The number of steps only changes the probability to be faced at each step. Dawkins talks of a slow, steady, cumulative climb against improbability. but there's only a finite amount of time to work with. The time since the Big Bang remains the same. If we slow down the steps from 200 every second to 1 every week, then the number of steps available since the Big Bang goes down by about 10 to the power 8, and the improbability to be faced at each step goes up by 10 to the 8. The total improbability remains exactly the same. Dawkins seems to think that something like natural selection might happen with non-living components like enzymes. But outside of a living organism, enzymes have no function at all and only a limited lifetime. Enzymes, like all proteins, have to be made of only left-handed amino acids. With one right-handed amino acid, an enzyme doesn't work. But every now and then, amino acids spontaneously switch from right to left, and after a while they switch back again. This is called racemization. Until enzymes have a cell to survive in, they can't take part in any kind of life processes at all, and they can't just hang around waiting for an enzymeless protocell to appear. Hoyle understood that, and he realized that producing all the enzymes needed for the simplest protobacterium was not enough. Without the rest of the protobacterium, those enzymes are utterly useless. And without the enzymes, the protobacterium cannot function. The protobacterium is vastly less probable than just the enzymes, so the idea of life emerging from non-life all by itself is nonsense of a high order. It has a probability like that of a hurricane blowing through a junkyard and producing a Boeing 747 all ready to fly. Hoyle was an atheist, but he was an honest atheist. In every branch of science that he researched, he realized there had to be intelligence behind everything he discovered. He wrote, "The creation of the universe, like the solution of the Rubik's Cube, requires an intelligence." He wrote, "A common sense interpretation of the facts suggests that a super intellect has monkeyed with physics, as well as with chemistry and biology." That shouldn't surprise us. Without him, nothing was made that was made. And since the creation of the world, his attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things which are made. Just over 20 years ago, when Hoyle was in his 80s, he went hiking and fell into a ravine, where he lay for hours till a tracker dog found him, alive but badly damaged. He would have had time to consider the things his life's work had shown him before meeting the super intellect he'd found dominating physics, chemistry, biology, and every aspect of creation. In the last of the three Dawkins clips which we looked at two episodes ago, he assured us that the origin of life is just a chemistry problem, and all we need to explain the origin of life is a plausible scenario which the chemists are working on. Let's have a look at that claim next time. Thank you for joining me for this episode. If you enjoyed it, please like, subscribe, and press the bell so that you'll be notified as I release new movies. If you'd like to support this project, you're welcome to do so through Patreon. Find a link on my channel banner and in the description below.